Tonight, friends, the second coming of Christ in glory. I just love those songs that we just sang, don't you? Turn to Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19. And here, of course, we have the ultimate fulfillment of the marriage of the Lamb and His invitation to the whole universe, as it were, of righteous beings, angels and men, to be participants in this great wedding. And so we have the Hallelujah Chorus now in chapter 19, verse 1, the only place in the whole New Testament where the word Hallelujah is even used at all. And here you see it over and over and over again. Hallelujah means what? Praise ye the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. 19, verse 1. After these things I heard, as it were, a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Hallelujah! Salvation and glory and power belong to our God, because His judgments are true and righteous. Stop right there. When we get to heaven and are glorified in the presence of Jesus, when we see Him, we'll be like Him, we see Him as He is, we'll always, evermore, see things through His eyes. We'll see that what He does is right, just, and holy. There'll be no complaints then, because we'll be one with Him as His bride and His body forever. So the righteous judgments that He will pour upon the earth as described in chapters 6 through 18 are viewed by glorified saints in heaven as being perfect expressions of the character of God. Okay? Now jump down to verse 3. Hallelujah. Jump down to verse 4. Hallelujah. Jump down to verse 6. And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, and as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of many peals of thunder, saying, Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty, the Omnipotent, reigns. You see, friends, today we live in an era, an age, a dispensation where God's power is questioned everywhere. If things are as bad as the Bible says they are, and as we actually see they are becoming, why doesn't God do something about this? And many people are saying because He doesn't care, or even if He does care, He doesn't have the power to do anything about it. In other words, God has blasphemed constantly in the hearts of sinful people. And occasionally we ourselves as believers have our doubts, don't we, and our questions. Just like the book of Job, a very important book in the Old Testament, showing you that even one of the greatest saints who ever lived struggled desperately with this issue. Is God merciful? Is God gracious? Is God dealing with this situation in a righteous, fair, perfect way? And of course we know how the book ends. God wins and Job says, I lose. I repent and abhor myself in dust and ashes. So friends, when we get to heaven at the second coming, we'll all agree with Jesus, won't we, that what He's done is right. We'll be amazed that He has saved anybody at all. Now, verse number 7. Let us rejoice and be glad and give glory to Him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and His bride has made herself ready. Now, all through the Bible, God says, rejoice, rejoice always. Why? Because it's all going to work out well. In fact, all things do what? They work. They work how? Together. For what? For good. To whom? To them who are called according to His purpose. Everything is under control in God's purpose for the world, even if you and I can't see it. And I say, Lord, help us to believe Your Bible, Your written revelation that fills in the enormous blanks and fog and cloud and mist and darkness in our mind and even in our heart concerning what You're doing in the world. Okay? Let's rejoice. Remember Psalm 17. When I awake, I will be satisfied in Your presence. No saint will go to heaven and say, oh, I wish it were better, or I had thought it would be better, or I'm so disappointed. Never. John the Baptist himself said, as he turned his disciples over to Jesus, He said, I'm just the friend of the bridegroom. I'm not part of the bride. I'm just a friend. He knew that something new was coming, namely the church. That's a mystery. That's a marvel. How much did John the Baptist know about the coming of the bride of Christ? He said, he must increase, but what? I must decrease. And in all of this, my joy is fulfilled. The purpose for which I came into the world to be the forerunner has been fulfilled by turning my disciples over to him. Okay? Now, friends, the marriage of the Lamb, according to Jewish custom, which I think we'd have to agree is probably the way the Bible understands it, is always in two parts. First of all, the bridegroom with a great glorious procession goes to the home of the bride, having provided the dowry for her parents, of course, and this is an elaborate ritual, and takes the bride away from mother and dad, and in a greater procession with torches and lamps goes through the city to bring his bride to his home. Okay? Well, now, where is the bride's home today? The bride of Christ. It's in heaven. Our citizenship is in heaven, from whence we look for the Savior who will transform this body of humiliation into a glorious body, like he's able to do all things. Now, friends, our home is there. We're strangers here. So the first part of the marriage is in heaven. That's what's described here. Then before the chapter's over with, in a great triumphant procession, Jesus will bring his glorified, purified bride back with him from heaven to the earth, which is his home, because the Father's going to give him this whole earth as his kingdom. Now, that's a very important part of the Old Testament prophecies of Messiah, you remember. Jesus said so in Psalm 2. I will declare the decree, says Jesus, Psalm 2, verse 7. The Lord has said unto me, Thou art my Son, this day have I begotten thee, referring to his resurrection. Ask of me, and I will give thee the heathen for thine inheritance, and the uttermost part of the earth for thy possession. Thou shalt break them with a rod of iron and dash them in pieces like a potter's vessel. That is Armageddon. And friends, tonight, we're going to see how that eventuates after Christ brings his bride with him to the earth for part two of the great wedding, the marriage of the Lamb. Okay? Now, watch the sequence of events here and the details. This is absolutely spectacular. Jesus just can't wait for this event to happen. In fact, he told us to pray for it, didn't he? You remember the prayer? Our Father who art in heaven, he told us to pray, hallowed be thy name, and what? Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth. Now, this is not heaven. We're earth now, see? We're premillennialists in terms of the fact the kingdom's on earth. And I, even as it's done in heaven, I say, thank you, Lord Jesus, for telling us you are excited about that event. You just can't wait to introduce your bride to your home on earth, now purged of demons, Satan, sinful people, and all corruption in government. Can you imagine that? All government corruption gone. Perfect administration, perfect education. All schools will be conspicuous for the absence of the teaching of evolution. Thank you. I say, Lord Jesus, help me to understand. Only you can do this. I'll do what I can to help it to happen now, but it won't. We're not pessimists. We're realists. God says, as much as lies within you, do good to all men. I mean, try hard. Vote for the right people. Do the best you can. But don't ever think to yourself, we will bring in the kingdom. It won't happen. It can't. That is blasphemy. Jesus said, you look to me. I'll handle that one. You just do my will, wherever you are, and I will take care of the ultimate results myself. You know, premillennialists are often accused of being pessimists. That we just give up, there's no use of trying, it's all hopeless. No. We are sending missionaries to the ends of the earth, we're reaching out to people everywhere if we're biblically, mature. We do everything we can, but we're realistic too, friends, that it can't happen ultimately. Satan cannot be defeated totally apart from Jesus Christ, the Lord. Okay? Now, here we go. I like this eighth verse, don't you? Would you like to know what you're going to wear for the wedding? Here we go. Well, at the end of verse 7, the bride has made herself ready. She has confessed. She has, in some cases, been ashamed before him that is coming. Remember 1 John 2:28, and now little children abide in him, that when he shall appear, you should not be ashamed before him, because you haven't done his will. You haven't honored his name adequately. You have been an embarrassment to him at times. But then it'll be rectified. You will have confessed it. You will be clothed appropriately. And you and I will participate in that bema, as we saw, you remember, Sunday. Okay? And it was given to her to clothe herself. Notice how she's involved in this. The bride, the church, in fine linen, bright and clean. For the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints. Now, maybe some saints will have thinner linen than other saints, somewhat less glorious maybe than other saints, who are rich, will be richly rewarded, but will all be there. There's no division of the body of Christ, friends. No matter how weak and frail and feeble a Christian may be, he or she will be there in glory on that occasion. Now, guess who gets invited to the wedding? Look at verse 9. And he said to me, write, blessed are those who are invited to the marriage supper of the Lamb. These are the true words of God. Now, would you kindly agree with me? The bride doesn't have to be invited. Well, then who's invited? Remember, there are lots and lots of saints who are not here. Now, let's remember, please, who are the only saints in heaven during these 7 years? Christians, the body and bride of Christ, which began on the day of Pentecost and had never existed before. It was never hinted at in the Old Testament. Jesus hinted at it just a couple times in Matthew. You know, I will build my church, ecclesia, but the apostles couldn't possibly have understood what he meant. In fact, it took him years to begin to find out what the church was. Remember how Peter struggled with what the church was? Paul had to rebuke him once at Antioch over those issues. They were confused about the true function and identity of the church, you see. But it began on the day of Pentecost, okay, and will end at the rapture. Now, people have already asked me this evening. I admit, friends, that this takes months in graduate school to go through intricately all these passages. It's an enormously complex issue. May I try to just say it in a few words again? That believers, all the way from Adam and Eve down to the day of Pentecost, were born again by the grace of God through the merits of Jesus, through simple faith in the Word of God illuminated by the Holy Spirit. That's the only way anybody ever gets saved. But the bride and body of Christ is special. They are baptized by Christ in the Holy Spirit into His body and bride. That's a unique position, higher than any saints have ever had or ever will. Okay? And at the rapture, now here's where it gets complicated, see? At the rapture, no more Christians will ever be added to the body of Christ. That's it. And those who miss the rapture are not necessarily going to be lost. They can be saved. Remember, we saw last night, in spite of the horrible persecutions of the Antichrist, millions of Gentiles will believe the true gospel of Jesus Christ proclaimed by the 144,000 witnesses, the gospel of the finished work of Jesus and His resurrection from the dead, but with a kingdom emphasis. Here's how Jesus described that kind of preaching. This gospel of the kingdom must be proclaimed to all nations, Gentiles, before the end comes. So Gentiles who are saved through their preaching don't become Christians. They become what? Proselytes to Israel. They become Israelites to a certain extent, just like in the Old Testament. And we always think of Ruth the Moabitess, who became an Israelite and adopted the God of her mother-in-law. You remember Naomi? and became incorporated into Israel. In fact, she married an Israeli and became an ancestress of Jesus. Now, that's hard for Christians to fathom. I mean, we don't even think that way in the church age. But in the Old Testament, in order to function as a priest, you couldn't even be a proselyte. It wasn't even enough to be an Israelite. You had to be a what? A Levite. And that even that wasn't enough to be a priest. You had to be an Aaronic Levite. A very complex system, dear friends, in the Old Testament, which will be reintroduced during the 70th week of Daniel down here, while Christians are being evaluated and rewarded up here. Okay? Two different kinds of saints. Okay? And I say, Lord, this is kind of complicated. But God says, trust me, I have a program here. I want you to understand that I'm consistent with. Okay? I have a covenant promise with Israel through Abraham. The new covenant will be implemented in Israel, and all Israel will be saved, which can't mean the church. How can the church be the fulfillment of the fact that all Israel will be saved? And I say, well, now, Lord, help me here. Who is invited to the wedding then? Other saints that aren't Christians. Like who? Old Testament saints, including John the Baptist, who was one of the last of them, right? He'll get invited. Think so? Thank you. Okay. Second group. All tribulation martyrs will be raised from the dead and invited. Okay? Because the Old Testament saints will not be resurrected until they are at the end of the 70th week. See, only Christians are resurrected before at the time of the rapture. But Old Testament saints are resurrected here. How do you know? Because Daniel said so. He said, after that tribulation, many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth will awaken to everlasting life. After the tribulation. You understand Daniel knew nothing about the rapture? Knew nothing about the church? Okay? So all these Old Testament saints, they're over here, aren't they? Where are we? Okay. And all the tribulation martyrs who died will be raised to welcome Jesus back. And who else? What's the third group? Living saints who have not yet been martyred, namely Jews and Jewish proselytes who somehow survived the Great Tribulation and enter into the millennium alive with mortal bodies and sin natures to reproduce into the kingdom age and repopulate the world. Now there's a fourth group I'm not sure about. If you are sure, please tell me. Will angels be invited? Thank you. I don't know either. Okay. Now, back to Revelation 19, friends. Are you still there? Here we go. Blessed are those who are invited, verse 9, to the marriage supper of the Lamb. Oh, John the Apostle is overwhelmed. In fact, he is so overwhelmed by this messenger that came to him that he falls down to worship him. I mean, all kinds of angels all through these chapters have appeared to him, and sometimes God talked to him, and he's not taking any chances. He says, I'm going to fall down and worship you, sir, whoever you are. And I fell at his feet to worship him, and he said to me, do not do that. I'm a fellow servant of yours and your brethren who hold the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. You see, so this angel says, don't you dare worship me. I'm a mere creature like you are. That's interesting. Because in chapter 2, John does the same thing, and he's rebuked again. By the way, did you know there's an infinite difference between an angel and God? An unbridgeable chasm. And angels know that, even if many people are confused. Angels are desperately concerned that they are never worshipped. The only angel who ever wanted to be worshipped is who? Satan. Right. Infinite blasphemy. Verse 11. Here we go, folks. The second coming is about to begin. And remember, you'll be there if you are a born-again Christian tonight. Here we go. Verse 11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat upon it called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and wages war. A white horse. Now careful here. What did he ride on coming into Jerusalem with a triumphal entry? Just a donkey, just a very humble animal. But now he comes as a warrior on a horse. By the way, in the Old Testament, and even in the New, a horse is one of the most deadly implements of war. A horse. Okay? To drag especially a chariot behind it, almost invincible. And I say, well, Lord, I'm impressed that there are two white horses in Revelation. The first one is in Revelation 6:1, ridden by none other than the Antichrist, who pretends to be the Christ. And Jesus launches him, go forth. And the Antichrist gallops forth, conquering and to conquer, claiming he's the Messiah. See? The imitator of the Christ. But here's the real Christ, folks. Riding on a white horse. Yes. And if you want to know who he is, he's faithful and true. The opposite of the Antichrist, who is unfaithful and false. And look how he judges and wages war. Ever heard of a warrior like this one? Who only wages war, how? In righteousness. Now that's what I call discriminate warfare. Do you know that no army in the history of the world has ever been able to do that? As I mentioned Sunday, I think it was, my father was a great military leader, strategist, tactician, a graduate of West Point, a chief of staff under General Patton in the Third Army in the Second World War. And friends, I want you to know something. No matter how careful an army is, a general, you can't guarantee that every person you kill is an evil person. There's all kinds of, I hate these words, friendly fire. Some of your own soldiers get killed. Innocent civilians get killed when bombs fall down. You can't drop a bomb that's so smart that it only hits bad people. But Jesus can and will. How can he do it? Next verse tells you. Because he has eyes as what? As a flame of fire. He can see, and I have an announcement to make. Jesus can see in the dark. Count on it. Eyes like a flame of fire. He knows exactly whom he is targeting at Armageddon as he comes down from heaven. My. Well, who in the world is this person? Keep reading. Upon his head are many diadems. He has a name written upon him which no one except himself knows. You say, what does that mean? Well, you know, friends, in the Old Testament, we have hints of this. When the parents of Samson met the pre-incarnate Christ, who told them about their son Samson, and he'd begin to win victories against the Philistines, they said, well, when this begins to happen, we want to come back and thank you. What is your name? And what did he say? Why do you ask my name? Since it is wonderful, Peleth. It is ineffable. Inexplicable. It is infinite. And that's what Isaiah later said, and his name should be called what? Wonderful. Same word base. Counselor. Wonderful Counselor. Mighty God. Everlasting Father. Prince of Peace. What a name he has. A name does what in the Bible? It tells you what the person is, his character, his function. Look at these names that only he himself knew. Of course, in Matthew 11, he says, no man knows the Father but the Son. And no man really knows the Son but the Father and to him to whom he reveals him. My character is infinite. My. And not only that, verse 13, he is clothed with a robe dipped in blood. And this time, folks, it's not his blood. Because this is a fulfillment, you see, of Isaiah 63. He will come through from Edom to Armageddon, creating a river of blood even to the bridles horses of the horses in depth. And it isn't his blood, it's the blood of his enemies. This is awesome. Okay? And I say, Lord Jesus, what are you going to do to this world when you come back? Well, friends, let's look at something else before I comment further on that point. Look who's coming with him. Okay? His name is called the Word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. That's you. But wait a minute. Wait a minute. Only one person in that army has a weapon. And it's the general, and he's in the front, not the rear. Now, not even General Patton ever dared do that in the Third Army. No. He was in the back, and the soldiers with weapons were in the front, or he would have been wiped out. But who is this person? Okay? He is the incarnate Word of God. That's John 1:1. In the beginning was what? The Word. And the Word is with God. And the Word was God. And I say, Lord, I am very, very traumatized by this. Because out of his mouth, verse 15, comes a sharp sword, so that with it he may smite the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron, and he treads the winepress of the wrath, of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. Oh my. Well, friends, that's what God the Father promised him 3,000 years ago in Psalm 110:1. David recorded it by inspiration. The Lord said to my Lord, my descendant, Messiah, what? Sit thou at my right hand until what? I make your enemies the footstool of your feet. Now, what's that mean? Well, you remember when Joshua conquered the Canaanite generals? He said, put your neck on the ground and we're going to put our foot right on your neck, which means you are totally defeated. The footstool of your feet will be your enemies. And I say, well, Lord, that isn't true yet. Enemies of Jesus are on a total global rampage. And Jesus is waiting, waiting, waiting till the Father says, this is it. And friends, this is awesome. Absolutely astounding and shocking. Yes, he treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And I say, well, Lord, I can hardly imagine anything more stupendous than this. Well, may I suggest something as a possibility? Revelation 14 says that all the armies of the world will be gathered by the Antichrist, see, who will have ruled the world, see. And they'll all be gathered there at this northern portion of Israel, Armageddon, the Mount of Megiddo. It's a huge valley of Esdraelon, so gigantic that 100 million soldiers could be packed in there. And can you imagine what it's like as the Antichrist looks up with all of his armies of millions and millions of soldiers, and they see Jesus gradually descending from heaven in infinite dignity, followed by millions and millions of his people, the church. Can you hear the Antichrist say something like this? Jesus, we crucified you once. You set foot on this planet, we'll kill you again. Famous last words. Oh, friends, how awful. All he does is just speak the word, and millions drop dead like that. I mean, there's no battle, no war, nothing. It's one word from him. It's all over. Have you ever heard of a cruise missile, a smart bomb? I mean, it can guide through cities and hit certain buildings or drop in certain spots. It has kind of like sensors on it or guidance systems. Can you imagine what we've done in warfare technology? I want to make an announcement. Jesus has a better one. It's his word. You say, well, what's this sharp sword coming out of his mouth? That's a symbol of his word. You remember Hebrews 4:12. The word of God is living, powerful, sharper than a two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, joint and marrow, is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there's no man that is not naked and open before the eyes of him with whom we have to do. And all Jesus has to do is speak the word. That's the end of the war, of the confrontation, of the threat, of the blasphemy. By the way, did you know there was a sort of a precursor of that at the Garden of Gethsemane? You remember what happened? Judas Iscariot came with a little army with weapons to capture Jesus. And they said, are you Jesus of Nazareth? And what happened next? He said, I am. They all collapsed on the ground. Now, if I was one of those soldiers, I would have said to myself, I'm out of here. You know what that was? The invisible hand of God smashing that invasion. As if Jesus didn't even need 72,000 angels, you know, 12 legions. Just one angel could have handled the whole problem. To say nothing of his Father in heaven. Can you imagine the infinite insanity of fighting Jesus Christ? That's why Jesus said of Judas to his rescue, guess who came rushing forward? Peter, and sliced off. He missed his target and hit the guy's ear. Thanks a lot. Thank you, Peter. I really needed you. No. Put up your sword, for this is the hour and power of what? Darkness. Okay? Well, the darkness is going to end here, folks. Right here. The darkest time the world will ever know is right here. And the darkness is deepest just before what? The dawn. Okay? And God says, I want you to see what I'm going to do to honor my beloved Son, who has suffered the attacks and the insults and the blasphemies of billions of people for thousands of years. And I'm going to honor my Son. And he will do what? He will tread the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty and rule them with a rod of iron. By the way, are you interested in being part of a democracy? I am. I'd hate to be in a dictatorship, wouldn't you? But I have an announcement to make about that, too. When Jesus comes, there'll be a dictatorship. See? He's not going to have to be reelected every 4 years. May I mention that? He is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and he'll rule the world with a rod of iron for 1,000 years, and he will be the executive branch. He will be the legislative branch. He'll be the judiciary, all in one person. Isaiah says so. He'll be tricameral, one person. You say, how can one person rule the whole world by himself? Because he has very great qualifications. He's God. Wow. Look at that. He will rule them with a rod of iron. And on his robe and his thigh, he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. At the name of Jesus, someday what? Every knee will bow and every tongue will what? Confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. By the way, isn't this about time to say, Lord, talk to me now. What do I have to do to get on the right side of this thing? I've decided to make my vote. Did you vote today? Let's vote right now. Lord Jesus, I vote for you. I want to join you. I want to be part of you. I want to be with you forever and ever. Whatever you do is right. I want to be with you forever. Well, friends, next picture, please. Guess what's going to happen next? Look, as soon as the battle of Armageddon has been accomplished and Satan is out into the bottomless pit, the false prophet and the beast are out and in the bottomless pit. All the demons are gone. See? All the unbelievers that were in the army have disappeared. But there are other unbelievers who weren't in the army. Now watch what happens to them. Jesus then, during this period right here of 75 days, this is all predicted in Daniel 12. Now watch what happens. During this period of 75 days, the first part of the millennial kingdom, there will be a systematic, total cleansing and purging of the human race of all remaining unbelievers. First group. First is the soldiers, the armies, gone. Then all the political leaders will be gathered in the Valley of Jehoshaphat just east of Jerusalem, just depicted by Joel the prophet and confirmed by Jesus in Matthew 25. They're called the sheep and goat nations. all the national leaders of the world will be brought to Jesus, will be confronting them and saying to them what? Because you showed mercy to these my brethren, these 144,000 missionaries, you may enter my kingdom alive. But those of you who did not honor me, because you dishonored my missionaries, my servants, my brethren, these witnesses, you are to be removed from the world immediately. You're doomed. Okay, that's Matthew 25. The sheep nations are the believers of Gentiles, and the goats are what? The unbelievers of Gentile peoples. Okay, third group will be dealt with. This is Ezekiel 20. All Jews who somehow still don't believe in Jesus. Remember, the vast majority of Israelis have been saved. Jesus said that Elijah would restore all things. Malachi said the same. Now, there'll be a few Jews, however, who still have not believed. And Ezekiel 20 says, God will purge them out and not allow them to enter his promised land. A remnant of unbelieving Jews, Israelis, will be dealt with. Okay? The vast majority of Jews are saved, mainly by here. See? And they'll be protected in the wilderness for 3.5 years. This is Revelation 12. And the witnesses will be protected supernaturally. That doesn't mean they're floating around the earth in air-conditioned, bulletproof Pope-mobiles. They'll be suffering like Paul the Apostle did until their witness is finished. Okay? Through them, millions of Gentiles saved. Born again. Members, in a sense, of the people of Israel. They're servants. Okay? They're supporters. But wait a minute. There's another group. Now, this is so meticulous. Nothing is left to chance here, friends. And just to look at it carefully, I invite you to turn now to Daniel chapter 12. Let's do it. Remember, you can't understand Revelation unless you understand what? Daniel, thank you. Let him who reads understand, Jesus said. So back we go to the book of Daniel. Chapter 12, the final chapter of the book of Daniel. Verse 11. And from the time that the regular sacrifice is abolished. And what? The abomination of desolation is set up. Now that is one of the most horrible events in the history of the world. Right here. See it? See that dot right there? That represents what Jesus said. When you see that happen, get out of Jerusalem. Flee for your lives. Because that is when the false prophet sets up an image of the beast, and it comes alive and kills people who won't bow before it. Okay? A horrible perversion. And from the time that that is set up, now catch the words here. All right? There will be 1,290 days. You say, wait a minute. 1,290? I thought the second coming is 1,260 after the. That's right. See? From here to here is what? Time times half a time, 42 months, 1,260 days exactly. And Jesus said if those days aren't shortened to exactly that number, no human being would survive the tribulation. Okay, that is when the second coming happens. Then what's this 1,290 then? That's 30 days more, during which time the temple is being cleansed, purged, purified, and reestablished for the millennial kingdom worship services. See it? Okay. But we're not done yet. Here's an even more amazing statement. Look at verse 12. How blessed is he who keeps waiting and attains to the 1,335 days. What's that? An extra 45 days now. Well, what's going to happen then? Are you ready? Look. By the end of that period, right in here, if you're still alive, you're a believer. Because everybody else is dead. Now you say, now say that again, sir, please. Look at, blessed is he who keeps waiting and attains to the 1,335 days. Now Jesus said, you know, he that endures to the end, the same will be saved, which doesn't mean if you die ahead of time, you're lost. It means if you're still alive, then you're saved. That's the way the Genesis flood ended, by the way. Anyone who survived to the end of the flood year, which is 371 days, is a believer. Why? Because everyone else is dead. Now that's what Jesus said is going to happen next. Now listen to this. He said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be when the Son of Man returns. For in those days men were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage and knew not till the flood came, till Noah entered the ark and the flood came and what? Took them all away. Took who away? The believers or unbelievers? The unbelievers. And believers remain on earth and repopulated the world. So shall it be, he said, when the Son of Man returns, two will be in the field and one taken away and the other left. Now who's taken away, the righteous or the wicked? The wicked. A reverse rapture. See? All unbelievers, even just ordinary people out in the field, in their homes, one taken, the other left. Because not one unbeliever can enter the kingdom alive. I mean, by the time you've arrived here, friends, if you're still around, you're a believer. Everybody else is dead. Then the kingdom is inaugurated. The inaugural banquet. Jesus said, there'll be Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, all the prophets. They'll all be there. And I'll come and serve you. And the whole menu was announced in Isaiah 25. There'll be the feast of fat things. Jesus said there'll be wine served there. Perfect, delicious, and pure wine. You say, really? He says, I will never again taste the fruit of the vine until when? Till I taste it new with you in the kingdom of my Father. Jesus can't wait for the inaugural banquet. I mean, everybody will be there. All Old Testament saints, tribulation martyrs, tribulation survivors. Millions of people will be there to inaugurate the final phase of the history of the world, which is a vestibule of heaven, in which Israel will be the number one nation of the world, see, and all her priests will be the teachers, the official teachers of doctrine and theology to all peoples on this earth. And guess what? The population explosion will be absolutely astronomical. Trust me, there'll be no more abortions, even partial birth abortions. Can you imagine? I never believed I would live to hear these things talked about. Okay? How many Americans have died by being killed by their own mothers before they're born? Tens of millions! Not one will happen then. And nobody's going to get sick, and nobody dies with rare exceptions. And the population explosion will be stupendous. There'll be billions and billions of people. We can't imagine how this earth was designed to accommodate vast numbers of people, more than we can imagine. So that by the end of the millennium, friends, the world will be filled with people under the jurisdiction of Israel on earth and the glorified saints ruling over the earth under Jesus for the 1,000-year preparation for the eternal state.